The title is actually misleading here. I'm not going to talk about infinity at all. I'm just going to talk about big numbers. Okay, and let's start here. So who here plays poker? A few poker players. Who here has ever seen a royal straight flush? Oh, one. That's surprising. I wasn't expecting one of you to have seen it. Who here has won the lottery? Nobody? I guess it's kind of a biased question, because had you won the lottery, you wouldn't be here, right? Who here has ever been struck to death by lightning? Still nobody? Okay, these events are all very rare. They occur about once in a million. So, like lightning, 6 or 7 Canadian people die every year of lightning. It's very rare. And yet we talk about millions, the number millions, like it doesn't seem that big when you talk about millions. But that's already about the things that we will never observe in our lives if we don't search for them. Okay, but that's still a small number for mathematicians. So let's move to bigger numbers. So physicists, when they do this kind of going towards infinity, they always go 1,000, 1 million, 1 billion, 1 trillion. I'm going to go way faster at the mathematician speed, because we're not physicists, right? So you might have heard of the Higgs boson. So it was a great discovery of physics of the 2012. So they discovered the Higgs boson in the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland. And the way that they proved the existence of they showed that something like a big Higgs boson really existed, is by smashing protons together. So you have these protons going at near the speed of light, which smash each other. And once in a while, they create a Higgs boson. Now, when I say once in a while, it's very, very, very rarely. It's basically 1 in 10 to the 15. So once in 10 to the 15, a collision of protons create a Higgs boson. Now, it creates a big Higgs boson, but we cannot detect the Higgs boson. We can detect the aftermath, the consequences. It creates all the particles, and we observe that. Anyways, never mind with that. Just consider the fact that we need about 10 to the 15 collisions to finally get a Higgs boson. I don't know if you realize how hard it is. Because, for instance, for the first year, during the first year the Large Hadron Collider was working, they did 1 billion collisions every second. That's astronomical. If you're trying to compute it, it's hard for a computer to keep track of that. And yet, by doing 1 billion collisions every second, after 1 year, they found 7 Higgs bosons. Now, if I do an experiment, usually half of the time, it gets wrong. And if someone else does an experiment, even though he might be very good, I would expect him to kind of make a mistake at least once in 1,000 or once in 1,000,000 times. Now here, you have to do 10 to the 15 experiments to detect these Higgs boson. What's the probability of getting it wrong? Well, it seems astronomical. That's how hard detecting the Higgs boson is. You have to make a lot of collisions, and you have to make sure that there's not even a very small mistake. Now, so 10 to the 15 is a big number. That shows how big a number 10 to the 15 is. If you consider what's the chance of seeing the sun exploding in a day, well, you can kind of compute it. You can see that the sun lives about 10 to 10 billion years. What's the chance that on one particular day it explodes? Well, you get kind of the same numbers, or 10 to, once in 10 to the 17, something like that. And yet in the sky, we see stars exploding every day. That's how big these numbers are. Rare events in the universe occur all the time. Another rare event is the apparition of life, is abiogenesis, the fact that life can appear out of non-life, out of solid matter. Now, I don't have a problem with considering that abiogenesis is part of science. But I have a problem with scientists that would argue that this is part of science. Because usually these scientists will consider that what is science is really about falsifiable experiments. And yet abiogenesis states that life can appear out of nowhere. How can you prove that something cannot occur? Because if you want to falsify this, you have to say, to prove that life cannot appear out of nowhere. How do you falsify that? Mathematically, you can't. So if you apply falsifiability, you cannot say that life appearing out of nowhere is a scientific theory. Okay, maybe it's verifiable. Maybe we can do an experiment and see that life appeared out of nowhere. Well, you can kind of compute the probability of finding life appearing in a human experiment. Just consider that life, it took 100 million years for life to appear on Earth, and that there were other particles of Earth to create that. In a human experiment, we'd be limited to, well, maybe a pool of particles. We cannot have too many particles to deal with. And we don't have a million years ahead of us. Maybe we can do a human experiment in a matter of years, decades, maybe centuries, but not much more. And if you use this number to compute the probability of finding life appearing in a human experiment, you get something like 10 to the once in 10 to the 15 or 20. And that's very unlikely, like that's rarer than the Higgs boson. And somehow, detecting life appearing out of nowhere seems harder to avoid mistakes when you do that. I mean, when they analyzed a block from the moon, they found life and it was a mistake. So it seems very hard to prove that life can appear out of nowhere, given these numbers. That's how big these numbers are. Okay, let's move on to much bigger number, a Googol. A Googol is 10 to the 100. So one followed by 100 zeros. And it's extremely big. To give you an image of how big it is, if you consider the number of particles in the universe, it's about 10 to the 80. So Googol is much bigger than the number of particles in the universe. If you count anything in the universe, it will probably be less, or it will be about a Googol. So Googol is extremely big in sort of physical scale. It's the kind of number physicists don't talk about. And yet it's extremely small in combinatorics. Like if you take a set of cards, of 78 cards, the number of ways of shuffling this is more than a Googol. It's about a Googol. And 78 is very small. So if you consider like the number of data, of different data I can have on a computer, it's much, much bigger than Googol. So when you talk about combinatorics, Googol is very small. Now let's move on to a much bigger number, Googolplex. Googolplex is 10 to the 1 Googol. So it's a 1 followed by a Googol of zeros. Now a Googol, remind yourself that a Googol is bigger than the number of particles of the universe. So if you want to write down Googolplex, well, there's just not enough particles, that's just not enough space in the whole universe to write down this number. That's how big this number is. Now, I can go even further. If you consider my body, the shape of my body here. Yeah. It's nice looking, right? Sorry, I didn't plan to say that. If you consider the shape of my body, it's what makes me. And it's a combination of particles. And you might wonder, what's the number of combination of particles that make up a shape like my body? Well, you can compute it with quantum mechanics, and you obtain a number that's 10 to the 10 to the 70, which is much less than a Googolplex. A Googolplex is 10 to the 10 to the 100. So the number of combination of particles that make up me is much less than a Googolplex. Now this has a terrible consequence. If I walk one Googolplex meters in this direction, it actually works also if you walk in this direction. Let's walk in this direction. If you walk a Googolplex of meters, then you'll see a Googolplex number of shapes like me. And since there are less combination of particles that make up these shapes than the number of shapes that I will have seen, then almost surely I will see a great, great, great number of exact copies of me. And when I say exact, I mean exact. Like with the same combination, the exact same combinations of particles, the same motions as I have, the same ideas that I have. And this other dude right there, he's also talking about a Googolplex. That's how big this number is. It's about the number of combinations of things in the universe. Okay, but there's even bigger, there are even bigger numbers. So let's talk about an even bigger number. Let's talk about Graham's number. So this is from Number 5, which is a YouTube channel, awesome YouTube channel, to check it out. Okay, Graham's number. Now what's amazing with Graham's number is that it's actually the solution of a very simple, not simple, but a short mathematical problem, which it can be stated in 3 lines, and only involved the biggest number that's involved in the statement of this theorem is the number 4. It has to do with Ramsey theory. So Ramsey theory is the theory that works, that trying to answer questions like what's the minimum number of points that I need such that a certain condition is satisfied. So it's a condition of a certain number of particles so that combinatorial properties are satisfied. And with this theory, you quickly get to very, very big numbers. Now, to give you an idea of how big Graham's number is, so Graham is a mathematician in the 1970s. He actually used the number he created to give an upper bound on the solution of this problem. Now, to show you how big this number is, it's reached after 64 iterations. And the first iteration of Graham's number gives you this number here, 3 to the 3 to the 3 to the 3 to the 3, 7.6 billion times. Now, how big is that? If you take the 5 or 6, now Googolplex was 10 to the 10 to the 100. So if you take the 5 or 6 first digits here, then you already get a Googolplex. So here this number, which is 7.6 billion of them, it's just unimaginably bigger than the Googolplex. The Googolplex is nothing compared to the first iteration of Graham's number. Like, on the channel, there's a video about this on Number 5, and the guy who presents that says that if you try to imagine this number, then there's just not enough information in your brain to capture the information. And as your brain trying to get the idea of of Graham's number, it will have to collapse to a black hole to contain this message. And in fact, just the first iteration, it would not be enough to contain your collapsed brain to a black hole. It's not enough to contain this sort of information. That's how big this number is, and it's just the first iteration. And at each iteration, it grows unimaginably quickly.